Sudhiksha, and today I say, let's get into something that's been both a struggle and a revelation in my life. I grew up in a family where optimism was practically a religion. My mom would often remind me of this Latin saying, "Dum spiro spero," which means, while I breathe, I hope. It was her way of showing me that life always has a silver lining, and it was up to me to look for it. For the longest time, I convinced myself that I was an optimist. Whenever prompted, I would say, the glass is half full. But let me take you back to fifth grade, when that belief began to falter and the glass felt half empty. Let's set the scene. Bright pink room, bright lights, and a Barbie doll by my side. I found myself frantically typing into the search bar, how do I make myself look prettier? And then I moved on to eighth grade in the same room, where I'd scroll through reels and see girls who seemed perfect, lived perfect lives, and did all these perfect things that I couldn't relate to. Scrolling through images of other girls, each one a masterpiece of flawlessness, left me feeling like an unfinished rough sketch in a world that screams perfection. The double tap culture made me question if I'd ever be worthy in front of those high standards. Those who knew me back then know that I used to wear a mask long after the pandemic had ended. This was because hiding felt easier than being judged. In 10th grade, I realized my so-called optimism was a facade. A bad grade in math, my most dreaded subject, didn't motivate me to improve. Instead, it sent me into a spiral of self-doubt. I wasn't just questioning my grades, but my worth, whether I was smart enough, capable enough, or even pretty enough. I realized the glass half full had become the glass half empty, and it finally became the glass that broke. Optimism is defined as the belief in a brighter future, even in tough times. While often associated with happiness, I believe that those two are not synonyms. Being optimistic doesn't mean feeling happy all the time. It's about maintaining hope and resilience, even when you're angry or upset. It's the quiet conviction that despite the struggle, things will improve. On the other hand, pessimism is its counterpart. Pessimism is the tendency to expect the worst possible outcome. It's the belief that when things can go wrong, it inevitably will. These contrasting mindsets dictate our ability to find the silver lining. A psychological study was conducted where participants were asked to evaluate their success in a given activity. Optimists thought of themselves as doing better than what they actually did, while pessimists were more accurate. However, this accuracy often caused pessimists to give up, while optimists, because of their overestimation and having that illusion, believed that they'd done well and thought, oh, I'll do even better next time, which motivated them to try again. This persistence enabled optimists to achieve success at rates 4 to 5 times higher than pessimists. So we should all want to be optimists, right? But the fact is, we're not. Is that because we choose not to be? Why do some of us naturally see the silver lining, while others fixate on the negatives? Is it an inherent trait? Recent research points to genetics, a gene called COMT, short for catechol O-methyltransferase. This gene ties into the warrior-warrior hypothesis, which poses that people have different responses, either optimistic or pessimistic, based on the variant of the COMT gene they possess. The gene comes in two forms, VAL and MET. People with the VAL variant are known as warriors because they process dopamine more quickly, which makes them more resilient under stress, making them more optimistic. On the other hand, people with the MET variant are called warriors because they process dopamine more slowly, which makes them stress for longer, ruminate on problems, making them more pessimistic in nature. People with one of each variant fall somewhere in between, balancing both tendencies. This genetic difference explains why some of us naturally lean towards optimism, while others like me are more pessimistic. So you might be wondering, if I have the worrier gene, am I doomed to pessimism? The answer is a resounding no. Genetics account only for a small portion of what makes someone an optimist or a pessimist. The main and dominant factor of optimism is your individual choice. Research confirms that you get to choose your response in any situation. Martin Seligman, a psychologist, introduced the concept of learned optimism. His research revealed that optimism is not just a natural trait, but also a skill. It's something you can practice and develop, just like learning a new language or mastering a sport. You get to choose whether you are an optimist or a pessimist. Every day, I work towards becoming a better version of myself, because I now choose to face challenges with hope and resilience. Because I was insecure of my looks, I found opportunities to learn skills like makeup and experiment with fashion, while yoga helped me manage my stress. So the best part is that I don't wear a mask anymore. The person you see today only compares herself to who she was yesterday. Granted, I'm still really, really bad at math, but instead of dwelling upon a bad grade, I now roll up my sleeves and start studying. In the end, the glass isn't half full or half empty. It's refillable. And you have the power to decide what you'll fill it with. Thank you.